102 Springfield's Classic Rock. It's 5:35. And Billy Idol with Bax and Nagle and Rock 102. It is going to be a day that feels like fall. Mostly sunny and a high of 59 today. Tonight clear, low of 37. And then for tomorrow, a little nicer, sunny and a high of 66. It's about, 44 degrees right now in downtown Springfield. Hell of a show. Man, Scott Zolak will be joining us after 8 o'clock. Maybe. That'll be brought to you by Window World. Also, it's a Thunderbird Thursday. Your chance to win tickets to the opening day ceremonies on Saturday, plus the keyword to cash, plus we get that Tom Petty thing to give away. There's a lot going on today. Bax and Nagle, Rock 102.
Listening.
Living it up when I'm going down.
Rock 102, Springfield's Classic Rock. It's 5:51 and Aerosmith with Bax and Nagle on Rock 102.
Mix of sun and clouds today with a high of 58. Tomorrow, sunny with a high of 66. It's 44 right now in downtown Springfield.
Hollywood Trash is brought to you by Western Mass Masons for your foundation and chimney needs.
Somehow you... still care about what's happening in Hollywood. So, from Tinseltown, 3,000 miles away, it's Steve Nagle's Hollywood Trash.
Well, Tay-Tay has donated $5 million in relief efforts for communities struggling in the wake of Hurricanes Helene and Milton.
She got that kind of money?
I don't think she's good for it. I really don't.
I'd be careful that check doesn't bounce.
I know. Bouncing like that relationship she's got taunting all over the... flaunting all over the NFL.
I bet there's been a lot of bouncing going on in the last 12 months.
On their social media, the nonprofit organization Feeding America released a statement from the CEO that said they confirmed Smith's generous donation. We are grateful, incredibly grateful, to Taylor Swift and her generous $5 million donation to Hurricanes Helene and Milton relief efforts. This is on top of another $1 million she already donated last week to another
$6 million. Where's this money coming from?
I don't know. She donates a lot to the relief efforts. She made a similar contribution in the past, including $1 million towards natural disaster relief after storms impacted Tennessee in December of 2023. She also gave $100,000 to a family of a 44-year-old woman killed at the Kansas City Chiefs Super Bowl parade in February.
Wow, very generous. I need to find a way to get some Taylor Swift cash.
I'm telling you, all she needs to do is say she's dating you for a day. Not even a day. Just an hour.
You should start rumors.
That I'm dating Taylor Swift?
Yeah, why not?
Yeah, sure, why not?
I'm a happily married guy, but you're a single fella. I can see her with you.
Yeah.
Much more than I can see her with that guy now.
Yeah, I've never
Travis Kelce.
I've never dealt with any delusions of grandeur before.
No.
Yeah. Justin Timberlake's marriage to Jessica Biel is in crisis after the singer canceled a concert amid claims he was with another woman the night of his DUI arrest. Radar Online can reveal the sexy back star, 43, told fans he was postponing Tuesday night's concert in Newark, New Jersey due to an injury. But his announcement comes just days after it was revealed he was enjoying the company of his ex-business partner and his wife's stylist, Esty Stanley, when he got caught drunk driving. Can you imagine that? The wife's stylist?
Okay, yeah. But when you look like Jessica Biel, I gotta believe there's a lot of maintenance. You gotta keep the upkeep. On the other hand, how do you keep sexy, keep bringing sexy back? When these kinds of things are going to happen to you.
I'm bringing sexy back. Now give me another beer. And some peanuts. I want some peanuts like the salty ones they have at that fancy hotel I was coming from.
Right.
Timberlake's 12-year marriage was already stained, according to sources, after the singer was snapped holding hands with movie co-star Alicia Wainwright during a boozy night out in November of 2019. A source told Radar Online, Justin's life has been steadily unraveling since his DUI arrest. It actually sounds like it was unraveling before the DUI arrest.
Sounds that way, yes.
So that's what's going on with Mr. Timberlake. Garth Brooks just keeps getting worse and worse for this guy. He's catching heat after his lawyers publicly revealed his rape accuser's name They amended a complaint in federal court on Tuesday and included her actual name in it. They say they seem to justify it by citing one of her filings from last week. She said that if the court decided that she had to reveal her name to move forward with the case, she was willing to do that. Her lawyers put out a statement and didn't pull punches. Quote, Garth Brooks just revealed his true self. Out of spite and to punish, he publicly named a rape victim. They claimed it was because he thinks the laws don't apply to him. Meanwhile, Garth's lawyers cast doubt on the whole thing in a separate filing, calling him the victim of a shakedown.
All right.
They claim she came up with a, quote, malicious scheme to blackmail him into paying her millions because he didn't give her a salaried job with benefits. Garth briefly addressed the lawsuit at the start of the his podcast on Monday, calling it the elephant in the room. He told fans to settle in because it could take 2 years. So let's hold hands and take this trip together. He said that legally he couldn't say anything else, so that's where he left it. His wife, Trisha Yearwood, broke her silence earlier this week. She tweeted a photo on Monday of Garth singing with her at a concert in Vegas last month and captioned it, "Love One Another."
Well, you know, I mean, it is possible that these are phony charges, but it still doesn't look good. Still a two-year fight.
Yeah, two-year fight, and now it's coming out. I just read an article yesterday that he had multiple cell phones with different names that he would text people with so it wouldn't be linked back to him.
Right. Ah, well.
You know what? Never meet your heroes. That's what I'm saying.
Sometimes they're not good. It's not a good experience.
Jelly Roll just released the full 22-song track list for his new album, Beautifully Broken, which is out tomorrow. The album features 3 collaborations, and the other 19 are just him. They do the collaboration thing nowadays to sell records.
It's the only way to sell records.
By collaborating with somebody else?
Yeah.
Is that why Taylor Swift only did it once?
She only needed to do it once.
Or twice?
Well, a couple of times.
Or 3 times?
She's done it a number of times, but it's always been beneficial to the other person, not so much to her.
Green Day is celebrating the 30th anniversary of Dookie.
That's an old
song on outdated tech like 8-track tapes, mini discs, a Big Mouth Billy Bass, and a Teddy Ruxpin.
Why does it not? Why does 30 years seem to have gone by like that?
I have no idea.
Because, I mean, it didn't seem that long ago.
No, and we started playing Green Day 5 years ago when those songs became 25 years old. So think about that.
Wow.
J-Lo says her split with Ben Affleck was exactly what she needed, and she's excited to be single. What can I do when it's just me flying on my own? What if I'm just free?
Free as in, like, free from Ben, or free from you won't be prosecuted because of the whole Diddy thing?
Yeah, I'm wondering what kind of deal she made. Kim Kardashian was spotted at the annual Chain Fest Food Festival this past Saturday in L.A. wearing tight black leather pants, a cropped black tee with her hair long and straight, and soft pink blush with nude lip gloss makeup.
Well, she always had something to say.
Oh, my God, the last time I showed this much soft pink with nude lips was when Ray J plunged his Jacques Cousteau into my Harry Anna trench in that sex tape you can purchase on YouPorn for $39.95. You ever visit the Harry Anna trench?
No, I've never gone that
deep. It's deep, it's deep.
Caitlin?
Well, I never got that done and dirty with her mother, Chris Kim, but we once had a weekend of dirty classic television.
You did.
Yeah, first we watched...
What'd you see?
Oh, first we watched 8 Is Not Enough, starring P.P. Van Splatten. Then it was on to the animated show about a canine hero who performs his martial arts doggy style, and that, of course, the 70s cartoon Hong Kong Spooey. And finally, it was time for the show that goes all the way back to the frontier days that took us on a little trip to Ballnut Grove, where he covers her with a half pint, the classic Little Blouse and the Harry. Just stay away from that mean girl, Smelly Holson.
I was a bigger fan of Bum Smoke.
You like Bum Smoke?
That was a good show.
Bum Smoke. How about Banana Bonanza? Did you like that one, too?
I did like that one, too. Yeah.
And that is your Hollywood Trash on Rock 102.
Put her face up.
And now, Bax's View from the Couch. Brought to you by Rocky's Ace Hardware. Outdoor Power Headquarters. Steel, Ego, Craftsman, and Aaron's.
Hey, good morning, sports fans. How the heck are you? As you know, hockey fans are an unusual bunch. They're not like normal people. They're hockey people. Rugged, sturdy, rambunctious. They also display a remarkable mastery of otherwise unpronounceable names, such as Uwe Krupp, Miroslav Satan, Stanislav Nakash. I could go on. But as you know, the 2024-25 season has officially begun. For example, tonight, the Bruins have their home opener against the Montreal Canadiens, and that's certainly exciting business. But if you pay attention to the schedule, you might notice that on October 19th, the Bruins will be on the road in Utah to face the new expansion Utah Hockey Club, known purely as the Utah Hockey Club, which used to be the old Arizona Coyotes. Why am I telling you this? Because Tuesday night, the Utah Hockey Club started off their season at home with a 5-2 win over Chicago. And while that is impressive, the Salt Lake City Tribune reported yesterday that one of the remarkable aspects of that first game was the amount of beer sold in a single night. The Delta Center, which has been the home of the Utah Jazz for the last 33 years, obliterated previous records by reporting more than $120,000 in beer sales. Again, hockey fans are a different species. They're also very thirsty. They didn't seem to give a damn also that the single beer at the Delta Center was being sold for $15 a cup. So let's do the math. $120,000 divided by 15 equals 8,000 beers sold in an arena that holds 16,200 people. That means that less than half of those 16,200 people were drinking, and this is considered to be a record? Bruins fans knocked down 8,000 beers in a single period, and those beers only cost you $12.50. No, sir, I don't see this Utah experiment working out at all. You want to be a hockey fan in the state of Utah, you're going to have to put on your beer-drinking jersey and start acting right. Because while you might be impressed with those sort of numbers, the rest of the hockey world is looking at you like you're a bunch of amateurs, and that simply will not do. But hey, enough of my yapping. Sports brought to you by Rocky's Ace Hardware. Your steel back blower, backpack blower still isn't blowing? You need to take it to Keith at East Longmeadow at the Rockies location over there. Keith is a steel-trained technician. He will fix your blower and your chainsaw. Good people, rock-solid service, and a steel-trained technician at every Rockies Ace Hardware location. I'm back. That's my view from the couch.
Rock 102.
Rock 102, Springfield's Classic Rock. It's 6:12 and AC/DC with Bax and Nagle on Rock 102.
It is going to be a mix of sun and clouds today with a high of 58. Tomorrow, sunny with a high of 66. 44 right now in downtown Springfield.
Scott Zolak coming up after 8 o'clock along with the keyword to cash. It's also a Thunderbird Thursday. Your chance to win a four-pack of tickets to opening night against Laval on Saturday, plus a bunch of other great stuff thrown in there as well.
I always like to find cool things at thrift shops. And this was originally being sold at Ocean State Job Lot for $1, but I actually got it for 75 cents yesterday.
Get out of town.
Yeah.
Were you popping tags?
I was popping tags, and I got a book called Radio Announcer, Careers Without College. And it's a small little book telling all about the radio industry.
What a thrilling and dynamic industry this is, Steve.
Isn't it? Isn't it? Career title. Here's some fast facts for you.
Okay.
You ready? Career title, radio announcer. Minimum educational requirement, U.S. high school diploma, or in Canada, a high school diploma. Okay?
Okay.
Certification requirement, none. Canada, none. Salary range, ready to this? $7,100 to $102,676.
Wow, who's that guy?
I have no idea. The job outlook in the U.S., poor.
Really?
Now, let me see what year this is from. I'm just trying to see. Where do you find 1999?
Wow.
Yeah, that was 25 years ago.
That's thankfully the opportunities have grown exponentially over the last, what is it now? 25 years?
25 years.
Wow.
Here's some job responsibilities. Do you want to hear what that is?
I would love to hear what I'm responsible for.
Radio announcers work in the entertainment and news business. They help broadcast hours of music and entertainment programs. Announcers also provide important information. Many people listen to radio announcers each day. Radio announcers have a variety of duties.
Duties.
They read copy on the air. This written information may include news and weather reports. Some radio announcers play music, like Tom Petty, over and over again.
This is an informative publication you have here.
They also may talk about music. This is why it was 75 cents.
Right.
They also may talk about the music they play. Radio announcers do interviews. For example, they may interview local leaders, musical guests, or other interesting people. And the key takeaway from that, because they have the key takeaways at the bottom of the page.
Yeah.
Radio announcers read copy on the air.
That's not that's not false.
So that goes into to that part. What is the job like? You want to know?
Do I?
Radio announcers work at radio stations.
You don't say.
Radio stations have the equipment necessary to broadcast radio programs.
Sometimes.
Stations have microphones, compact disc players, tape players, and transmitters.
Tape players?
Transmitters send signals through tall radio tower antennas.
Steve, you have me on the edge of my seat. Go on.
Signals and electrical pulses. They become sound when radios receive them.
That's like magic.
Radio stations can be AM or FM. AM
Who
and
decides?
FM. AM and FM are different types of radio signals.
You don't say.
AM signals are usually carried farther than FM signals, but FM signals produce a much better sound quality. Would you like to know what the work environment is like? This is the juicy part.
This sounds like it's got the most meat attached to it.
Radio announcers work in booths. We actually work in a John Wilkes booth. These small rooms contain microphones, compact disc players,
right.
Cassette players, loudspeakers, and control boards. Some booths have computers.
You don't say.
A radio announcer usually sits at a table or desk. A microphone sits on the table or hangs in front of the radio announcer. The announcer speaks into the microphone. In case you didn't know how a microphone works.
That's what I'm doing wrong?
Yeah. The announcer uses the control board to start and stop music. This board has several buttons that control the compact disc and cassette players. The announcer also uses the control board to turn the microphone on and off.
This is like sorcery is what you're telling me over here, Steve.
A radio announcer may listen to loudspeakers as music and advertisements are played, but the announcer also wears headphones. The loudspeakers shut off when the announcer's microphone is turned on. The announcer then hears the program through the headphones. Silence on the radio is called dead air.
Too much silence on the radio is called unemployment.
Right. Radio announcers must avoid dead air.
Radio announcers must avoid unemployment, too.
Radio stations depend on music, sports, news, or talk to keep listeners interested. Listeners might change stations if the station has dead air.
Steve, can I just tell you this is maybe the best 75 cents you've ever spent in your whole life?
Listen to me, man. I'm always on the lookout for gold finds at thrift stores.
Well, this is one of them.
And this it spoke to me as I walked past the bin. It was sitting right on the top. It said radio announcer. And I'm like, that's me. You want to know what the hours are?
Yes. I'd love to hear this.
Many radio stations broadcast 24 hours each day. They broadcast 7 days a week. Radio announcers often work on weekends and holidays. Ain't that the truth? Many radio announcers do not work daytime hours. Beginning announcers usually work late at night. They also may work weekends. Fewer people listen to the radio late at night and on weekends.
Really?
Yeah. Radio announcers may move to a daytime shift when they have more experience.
Yes.
Experienced radio announcers usually work during the day. More people listen to the radio at this time. Experienced radio announcers generally are more skilled than new radio announcers.
Well, you know that's not right.
This is just pointing things out.
Yeah.
Was
this written by a 22 news reporter?
Probably.
This is what they saw.
Yeah. Oh, I think it says Nick Oresco in the back here. Is that what the author was? So that's the work environment.
Wow.
Personal qualities. Radio announcers must be knowledgeable to keep their audiences interested and informed.
Well,
we don't know jack squat.
Well, they got that one wrong.
For example, radio announcers need to be aware of current events. Newscasters might read newspapers and news magazines.
Steve, when was the last time you actually buried your nose in a news magazine?
1996?
Yeah, that's what I was thinking.
About that? Newscasters might read newspapers. Disc jockeys might read magazines about music and musicians. They also may go to concerts. Sportscasters might read sports magazines and sports sections of newspapers. They may also go to sporting events. hey, would you write this? Announcers must be dependable. Well,
throw that out the window.
Their programs begin and end at exact times. Yes, whenever exactly I get here, it begins, and whenever exactly I leave, it ends.
Right.
Announcers need to be to work on time. Where's the pilot?
I have never seen that.
Can I have a Sharpie so I can black that one out before I hand this to the boss? Radio announcers need to be aware of audience expectations. They don't expect anything from us.
I think people in this audience have no expectations.
Many people count on announcers to provide correct information. We do try to do that as best we can. That is something we do.
Doesn't mean we succeed at it.
No,
we try.
But we don't sit here and tell you, hey, by the way, hurricanes are created by the government.
Now you tell me.
Most radio announcers try to meet those expectations. And you can read all about this yourself. I'm going to leave this up in the lobby. If you feel like when you come by and you win a prize, perhaps, you can sit there and read this.
Well, maybe the winner of the Thunderbird Thursday prize pack could thumb through that for a brief second.
I would hope so. It says getting ahead. Oh, and they even have a glossary in the back.
Oh, in case there's something you're looking for specifically.
Yes. Here's words to know. Ready? Broadcast. Do you know what that means?
I believe it's a phishing term.
It's to send out programs on the radio.
Oop, I got that. Had that wrong.
Disc jockey.
I've heard that.
A radio announcer that plays mostly music.
Yes.
Drive time. That is the time of day when many people are driving to and from work. Format. Is that a guy for Matt?
That's one better than a three, Matt.
The kind of programs a radio station features. Intern. A person who learns a job or skill by working with an expert in the field, which is why none of our interns have gone on to do anything great. Radio station.
What is that?
A place that broadcasts radio programs. Transmitter, a device that sends out radio signals.
Wow.
Ratings, numbers that tell how many people listen to certain radio programs. And sometimes...
Or how many don't listen to certain radio programs.
Which is enough to put you on a billboard that says, we're number one.
With Amish.
And to learn more, contact Ed Bliss. And read his book, Now the News, The Story of Broadcast
Journalism. Yeah, Ed did good work on that one.
And see, here we are. Yeah. It's life has come full circle.
Since we're talking about radio, I should probably let everybody know, as some of you may be aware, Rock 102 was nominated for a Marconi Award by the National Association of Broadcasters. Well, last night was the ceremony, and I am delighted to tell you that the folks at... a station in Denver, Colorado, were the big winners, and we did not win.
So what?
It's an honor to be nominated.
We didn't win?
No, the Mountain in Denver, Colorado is the big winner. The Mountain.
The Rocks. Mountain.
I'm working for the Mountain. I bet they read that book.
Yeah. That's moving molehills all day long. It's the Mountain.
So they're the big winners. We were not, and we don't know where we placed. There were five stations, and we were among them, and we did not win.
All right, let's see who's on 99.5 The Mountain. Ready?
Uh-huh.
An adult rock station out of Denver, spinning the best classic rock.
I'm not sure, sir, so sure about that.
I don't even have, these major companies that group all their radio stations together don't even have information about the radio station anymore.
No, that's why it's the best rock station in America.
Oh. Let's see. Listen Live. Who's on?
Hard to tell. Doesn't really say.
Yeah, it doesn't say anything.
It does not say at all. Well, the schedule, I found the schedule. It says here that the morning show starts at 8 a.m.
Who is on the morning show?
Ian Camfield.
Oh, I know him.
Do you really?
No,
no, no, no, none of these people. Yeah. Anyway.
And they don't know who we are.
It's
either.
Just a pleasure to be nominated. It really isn't that what matters.
No, it would be nicer to win it so then we could taunt that to everybody.
It's 625 at Rock 102. 28 with Bax and Nagle and Rock 102.
Your Pioneer Valley forecast because Dan Brown dropped the ball. Dropped the ball.
It's like,
a little late, to the punch this morning. Anyway, mix of sun and clouds with a high of 58. Tomorrow, sunny with a high of 66. It's 44 right now in downtown Springfield.
He's probably so Milton focused that he can't even, that he's got other things in his mind.
Yeah, he's focused all the time.
Yeah, he is.
Yeah. Yeah, focused. We're focused.
Yes, we are.
Are we?
I don't know.
Do you want to laugh?
Yes, I would like
all
to
right,
laugh.
Let's laugh.
Yes, go
let's,
right
let's
ahead.
Do all that.
Right, here we go.
Right.
Here we go.
It's Bax and Nagle's joke of the day.
I'm funny how? I mean, funny like I'm a clown. I amuse you.
On Rock 102.
I make you laugh.
Springfield's classic rock.
Since it's, Halloween season.
Yeah.
What's a skeleton's favorite part of the house?
I don't know, Steve. What's a skeleton's favorite part of the house?
The living room. Get it?
Yes.
What instrument do skeletons play?
I don't know, Steve. What instrument do skeletons play?
The trombone.
The trombone.
What are you going to be for Halloween?
I don't know.
Drunk.
Yeah.
What do you call a cheesy Halloween dance?
I don't know. What do you call a cheesy Halloween dance?
The Munster Mash.
The Munster Mash.
Yeah. And why couldn't the witch have children?
Because warlocks have crystal balls?
No, her husband had a Halloweenie.
Oh, that's
see, yeah. See,
how did we not win that award?
I have no idea. None. By the way, this is a radio station in which we are transmitting radio signals over FM.
On our radio program.
Yes.
Yeah.
Bax and Nagle in the morning on Rock 102, Springfield's classic rock.
Let us help you tackle them.
With Bax and Nagle on Rock 102, it's time for news brought to you by Wohler's Builders. For sleek office makeovers to upgrading classrooms or adding ADA accessibility, here's local radio icon Steve Nagle.
Thanks, Bax. Hurricane Milton barreled into the Atlantic Ocean on Thursday after plowing across Florida as a Category 3 storm, pounding cities with ferocious winds and rain, whipping up a barrage of tornadoes and causing an unknown numbers of deaths. It compounded the misery wrought by Helene while sparing Tampa a direct hit. Does that mean anything? It's still making a direct hit somewhere.
Yeah, and Tampa got messed up. I mean, they may not have gotten the direct hit, but you know, that's a 300-mile wide storm.
It's the storm surge that comes after that is the more dangerous part on top of the wind and all that other stuff. The storm tracked to the south in the final hours and made landfall Wednesday night in Siesta Key. The situation in the Tampa area was still a major emergency as St. Petersburg recorded over 16 inches of rain, prompting the National Weather Service to warn of flash flooding as well as other parts of western and central Florida. The storm knocked out power to a large section of Florida with more than 3 million homes and businesses without electricity, according to Power Outages US, which tracks utility reports. St. Petersburg residents also could no longer get water from their household taps because a water main break led to the city's shutdown service. Before Milton even made landfall, tornadoes touched down across the state. Did you see some of the videos of this? It was like looking at Oklahoma.
They were having like hundreds of reported tornadoes all over the area.
The Spanish Lakes Country Club near Fort Pierce on Florida's Atlantic coast, which was particularly hit hard, with homes destroyed and some residents killed. We have lost some life, St. Lucie County Sheriff Keith Pearson told the local news, though he wouldn't say how many people were killed. About 125 homes were destroyed before the hurricane came ashore, many of them mobile homes and communities for senior citizens. About 90 minutes after making landfall, Milton was downgraded to a Category 2. By early Thursday, the hurricane was a Category 1 storm with maximum sustained winds of about 85 miles per hour and leaving the state near Cape Canaveral.
but the danger has not passed. Storm surge remained a concern in many parts of Florida, and tropical storm warnings were in place for much of the east central coast. Officials in Hardhood, Pinellas, and Sarasota counties urged people to stay off the roads, warning of downed power lines, trees and roadways, and blocked bridges. The storm may have passed, but it's still dangerous to be traveling this morning.
I'm watching this video of Tropicana Field in St. Petersburg, and the storm ripped the roof off. Now it's like a dome.
It's a fabric.
Stadium. It's fabric, yeah. but ripped the damn roof off.
But they were also housing 10,000 utility workers in there.
Yes.
That were ready to take on the storm as soon as it passes.
Yeah, see, that's the problem with it.
The good news is nobody got hurt. They didn't have any injuries or deaths or anything like that inside the dome. But hey, I think they wanted to get rid of that stadium anyway.
Well, I think they can replace the roof, but
yeah.
Man, it's a. I saw a bunch of videos last night of people saying, "Yeah, we're going to weather the storm. We're going to go, we're going to go through it." And the government is telling you, this is not a survivable storm. If you weren't able to get out, it might not be survivable. So, you hope that the numbers of death and injured are low, but this doesn't seem like the kind of storm that gives a damn and takes whatever it can get.
A guy texted me, I know, said his mother-in-law and sister-in-law are in Daytona right now and are getting hammered. That's where it's like leaving the state. And just because, and I was watching this guy last night. I'm on Amazon Prime.
Yep.
Has all these live, actually, it was Hulu. Hulu had this live 24-hour thing from ABC tracking the storm. And it's basically local TV stations down in Florida.
Right.
ABC affiliates. Doing the thing. And the guy says, listen, just because these things get downgraded to a category one doesn't mean that the storm surge, the storm surges are the worst part. That's what comes after. It's almost like it sucks and is bringing all the tide in. And that's where you get these 15-foot storm surges after the storm has passed. It's just crazy. It's just crazy to have to deal with something like that.
I got a friend of mine from high school. This is absolutely true. He'd been living in Virginia for like the last 30 years or so.
Yeah.
They just moved down to Orlando last weekend.
Really?
They just moved there. And they get hit by Milton.
Where's the welcome wagon?
I evacuated hundreds of miles away, hopefully. Yeah. So, I don't know. I mean, you're starting to see people say that they're safe, and I hope there's a whole lot more of those people that are able to do that,
yeah.
Because there are many of us that are kind of concerned about people we know and care about.
Well, it's a guy I know, a friend of mine, who lives right near where my mother used to live, and he stayed during that last one that they had down there, the Ian, a couple of years ago.
Yep.
And he's like, the streets were flooded out. And I said to him, like, dude, what are you doing? Like, why are you staying there? And he's like, it's not a big deal, that kind of thing. This time, he was smart enough to go to Hollywood, Florida, which is down near Miami.
Yeah.
Good move. Because it sounds like just because that Tampa didn't get a direct hit, that area did. That Sarasota, Venice area,
mm-hmm.
It sounds like it got hammered down there. So, you're trying to see people who are marked safe. I know people joke about the marked safe from this or that.
Yeah, but sometimes it's good to see.
It is good to see because you can't answer everybody. And if you get a signal for a couple of minutes, at least you can broadcast to everybody that, yeah, you know what? I might not have much cell service, but we're good.
Yeah.
We're good here. So, anything good going on in the news?
I hope so.
Here's a story. 22 News is saying goodbye to one of their colleagues, Melissa Torres, as she prepares to take the next step in her journalism career.
Okay, where's she going?
After three memorable years as a reporter with 22 News, Melissa will be moving up within their parent company, Nexstar Media Group, to a station just to the west. Reflecting on her time here in Massachusetts, she shared her heartfelt gratitude, and then she released the statement, which I refuse to read. Melissa's presence.
Yeah, you're not gonna tease us with that.
Melissa's presence at 22 News will be missed as she leaves a lasting impact on the station, the community, and the states she's covered with passion and dedication. I have no idea where she's going. It just said to the west.
Sounds like Albany, maybe?
Maybe. Probably.
Hmm. Well, good luck, Melissa.
Well, you got to move it on up to the west side.
In a deluxe apartment in Albany.
To a deluxe reporter in the sky. Residents on one street in West Springfield are requesting speed humps as cars fly down their street. My hump.
My lovely lady hump. What you gonna do with all that junk?
All that junk inside your trunk. The West Springfield Department of Public Works conducted a speed data analysis on the street and found unsettling numbers.
Steve, I believe it's pronounced analysis.
Have you ever been to West Springfield?
I have.
I believe it's pronounced analysis.
No, it is analysis.
Speed limit is 30 miles per hour, and you know what we're going to do? We're going to get a voicemail from that guy going, yeah, to the pumpkin head on the morning show. See, ain't no pumpkin head. Steve Nagle can't even pronounce the word analysis in analysis. It's ridiculous. I'm waiting for that voicemail. That guy's got, there's like 10 voicemails from that guy.
That
complains every day, yet continues to listen and is still mad that John O'Brien doesn't work here.
Well, sorry, but it's been a couple of years now.
Like three, I think, right?
Yes, and this guy still has a hair across his ass because of it.
I don't know why.
I don't know.
Anyway, the speed limit is 30 miles an hour, and even though the street is a hill on one side, the town accounted for how this may increase a driver's speed and placed the tracker about 150 feet from the end of the hill to see if drivers slowed down at all. Connor Knightley, the town engineer for West Springfield Town Council Department of Public Works, said the study was 1 week long, and at that time, 8,600 vehicles were analyzed.
Analyzed, Steve.
It's in West Springfield. Have you ever been there?
Yes, I have.
It's analyzed. It's analyzed. After tracking their speeds, 1,992 of the vehicles drove at speeds that would receive a violation from the police. That's 23% of drivers in just a one-week period. 15% of drivers were traveling 39 miles per hour or faster, and the fastest speed tracked was 66. That's a little excessive.
That's a bit much.
Over double the speed limit. One resident 22 News spoke to said they had to move her mailbox as going across the street was getting too dangerous. Residents are hoping to see speed humps installed soon. My humps. My lovely lady humps.
What you gonna do with all that junk?
All that junk inside your trunk? I'm going to get you drunk. Said the scheduling is impacted by weather and availability of the operations staff. And best case scenario, the humps, my lovely lady humps.
What you going to do with all that junk?
All that junk inside my trunk. I'm going to get you drunk. I'm saying it out of sequence, but you get the picture.
The drift is there.
In the best case scenario, the speed humps are installed this fall, but he said he wouldn't be surprised if their installation is scheduled for the spring of 2025. So there you go.
That's good to know.
Your Pioneer Valley forecast today is going to be a mix of sun and clouds with a high of 58. Tomorrow, sunny with a high of 66. It's 43 right now in downtown Springfield. I'm Steve Nagle, and that's the news on Rock 102. Oh, yeah.
Rock 102 and the Springfield Thunderbirds want to hook you up with a Rock 102 Springfield's Classic Rock at 6:53 and Elton John with Bax and Nagle at Rock 102.
Mix of sun and clouds today with a high of 58. Tomorrow, sunny with a high of 66. It's 43 right now in downtown Springfield.
So you've probably heard us talking about the Mayflower Marathon Comedy Night at the Armory on MGM Springfield on November 3rd. It's a Sunday night. It's brought to you by Dave Minor Exterior Home Improvement. It's going to be the big night of laughs to benefit the Open Pantry as we get ready for the Mayflower Marathon. Steve is going to be the headliner, along with our special guest Cody Montaigne and Andy McDermott. And I'm going to be serving as the host. And by the way, tickets are on sale now at rock102.com. Seating is limited, so buy yours now before they sell out. So, you know, as I've been getting ready for this position as the host, you wanted me to do 5 good minutes?
Yeah. You got one at least?
I right now I got like 15 seconds of real class A material, and I'm trying to put together other things. How professional do you want this to look?
it doesn't need to be professional.
Can I bring notes?
Sure, you can bring notes. Nobody, listen, nobody has any high expectations. I know you're not, like, in this.
Well, I haven't been in it in years.
Well, that's what I mean. So nobody's expecting you to be, like, come out and, you know, do your best George Carlin impression.
Yeah, well, that's never going to happen.
Right, but that's what I'm saying. You know, it's a tough thing to do. I get it. But at least you're doing it, and people recognize that. I think comedians build it up in their head that you're worse than you actually are sometimes.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, if you put work and effort into it, which you're doing.
Sure.
Then people recognize that. I don't think it's like, oh, my God, I'm never going to see that again because of his worst 5 minutes ever.
Yeah. If I were a major league pitcher, right, and I retired, like, years ago, but then, like, 30-some-odd years later, I'm asked to pitch to start in the World Series, I'm gonna guarantee I might not be as sharp as I was in my 20s.
I don't think you are. I don't think you are.
You don't think so?
No.
You don't put this at the World Series level?
No. Do you need one of those Whisper 2000s to put over your head so I can yell the jokes to you from backstage?
Yeah.
Do
actually,
the thing about the thing. Don't tell that joke.
Avoid the Ovaltine.
Do you remember the Whisper 2000?
I do remember the Whisper 2000.
All it was an amplifier. That's all it was. It was just a big, big giant microphone that you could do. You supposedly could hear people talking.
All right. Well, let's put it this way. I'm working on it. I got some things, working on. Some things I have to consider whether I can get away with, and some things I know I'm not going to be able to get away with.
Like a bad bowel movement, I'm working things out.
That's absolutely true. So we hope you can join us. It's going to be a great night. Sunday, November 3rd at MGM at the Armory, and it's all brought to you by Dave Minor Exterior Home Improvements and Rock 102 Springfield's Classic Rock.
Speaking of crap, they got this detour on I-90 in, I think it's like, Blandford or Westfield. It's the bridge. It's the big giant bridge that spans across the Westfield River.
Yeah.
Over on the Mass Pike. And that is like closed to truck traffic at nighttime. So all of these trucks that have to go from Lee to Westfield or Westfield to Lee have to get off.
Yeah.
And they have to get off the highway and take Route 20.
Okay.
Which means sometimes they go through my town. They take the shortcut through my town.
Sure.
And I was stuck behind this tractor trailer going up the mountain in through Montgomery this morning at a cool 10 miles an hour.
10?
Yeah. And it's for like 7 miles, right? And you know, obviously over the hill kind of thing.
But that's a no passing zone.
Yeah, but I'm stuck behind this this truck, this A. Dewey pile.
Ever have a Dewey pile?
Who came up with that name?
I'm sorry, I can't eat another bite. I've got the Dewey piles.
See, that would have been the name for the septic company, A Dewey Pile. not a company that delivers goods.
Right.
What does that say about you and your name, A Dewey Pile? I just don't understand why. When they're in a situation like that, you're in a two-lane road. Obviously, you have to take this route.
Right.
But when you see cars behind you and there is a pull-off at some point, because I can't pass somebody. I'm definitely not an idiot enough to pass an 18-wheeler on a two-lane country road. I'm not that brave. I'm sure there are people that would do something stupid like that.
Yeah.
But I'm not gonna take that chance. If you have a pull-off, which this guy had at least two, pull off and let the cars pass?
Yeah, I don't.
What is the deal with that?
I don't know. Well, you know, a lot of these drivers are really on the clock, so they have to make their deliveries at a certain time, and to pull over means they're losing time.
We're all on the clock.
Yeah, but their time is more valuable.
Why?
Well, one, I think they're getting paid more, and then two, there's somebody waiting for them at the end.
Who?
I don't know.
Who is waiting for a Dewey pile?
Sure, there are people.
Why would you have that name? That must be the guy's name.
It has to be.
A-D-U-I-E.
Right.
P-Y-L-E.
But every time I see it, I always thought about, sure wouldn't want a Dewey pile.
I know. You think before that left the boardroom, that would have been like, you think we should go with this name? Hell yeah!
a Dewey pile because we deliver crap.
But we do it cleanly.
I've said my piece.
It's 6:59, Rock 102.
Rock 102 wants to know, what would you say if you won $1,000?
Bax's View from the Couch, brought to you by Rocky's Ace Hardware, Outdoor Power Headquarters, Steel, Ego, Craftsman, and Aaron's.
Hey, good morning, sports fans. How the heck are you? Folks, if my employer were to lose their ever-loving minds and somehow offer me a contract that paid me $8 million a year, I would do whatever I could not to mess things up. I would immediately give up all my legally questionable activities and do my best not to put any of it at risk by doing something patently stupid. Sadly, not everybody enjoys a sort of keen insight into the ramifications of their actions like I do. Sometimes professional football players, for example, do not take into consideration the sort of consequences that may occur when they start acting up. Yesterday, the NFL placed Patriots team captain and starting safety Jabril Peppers on the commissioner's exempt list following his arrest last weekend for domestic assault and battery, assault with a deadly weapon, strangulation, and possession of a Class B substance believed to be cocaine. Now, each one of these charges individually could be enough to find yourself on the commissioner's exempt list. Stacking those charges all in a single night makes the likelihood of getting off the exempt list that much harder. Peppers, as you may recall, pled not guilty on Monday during his arraignment, also posted bail of just $2,500. So what does it mean to be put on the exempt list? It means that Jabril Peppers will not be allowed to play with the team, nor will be allowed to practice. He will, however, be allowed to collect a weekly paycheck of $153,846 per week. Listen, I know the legal system has rules about due process and everything, and I know that his next hearing is scheduled for November 22nd, but if the allegations against him are true, and they certainly seem to be, it would appear that perhaps he does not deserve a weekly paycheck of $153,846 a week, and that perhaps what he really deserves is a big fat smack of painful consequences instead, because there's a very good chance that he's earned it. But hey, enough of my yapping. Sports brought to you by Rocky's Ace Hardware. Tool steel chainsaws, one steel battery blower, one steel backpack blower. All $50 all month at Rocky's. It's a rare $50 off deal on the orange and white outdoor powerhouse workhorse. Steel plus a certified steel technician is available at every Rocky's Ace Hardware location. I'm back. That's my View from the Couch.
Rock 102, Springfield's classic rock.
Music Rock at 7:12 and the Rolling Stones of Bax and Nagle at Rock 102.
Mix of sun and clouds with a high of 58. Tomorrow, sunny with a high of 66. It's 43 right now in downtown Springfield.
Scott Zolak will be joining us after 8 o'clock today. It's also a Thunderbird Thursday. The Thunderbirds are opening up their season at home on Saturday against Laval. We have four packet tickets to give away a little bit later on. That includes the four hats, the four koozies, and a drawstring bag to hold all of that stuff in. So that's coming up later on this morning. And also after 8 o'clock, the keyword to cash, your chance to win 1,000 big ones.
$1,000.
$1,000.
That's pretty cool.
We'd love to have $1,000 and then go to a Thunderbirds game.
And we're not doing that very often, so make sure that you get your keywords in.
Yes. We're only doing it four times a day. So you know, you got to be very, very careful not to miss any of it.
For how long?
9,000 weeks. I believe.
9,000 weeks.
Don't know how long. I think it's at least a month.
Cookie Monster in the news.
Right. You do realize he's a fictional character, right?
Yeah. I also realize there's a hurricane going on right now, and there's going to be like massive devastation once the sun finally rises, you know, across the entire state of Florida, which is happening right about now. And they're going to be assessing all that, and then they're waiting for these storm surges to come in. So it's not like I'm ignoring that news. It's just that we don't have any other information other than, you know, there was a lot of wind and a lot of rain, and
right.
Now there's going to be a lot of flood. So
and when you get an important Cookie Monster story to fill in the time, I mean, you got to seize the moment.
Well, stories like this bring everybody together, don't they? In times of
sometimes,
turmoil,
yes, yes.
You know, in times of when the country is in turmoil.
I know when some people are at their end of their rope, they always wonder, God, I wonder how the Muppets are doing right now.
Well, Cookie Monster got caught speeding in Germany. Cops in Dortmund, Germany, released a traffic cam shot of the Muppet doing 60 in a 50-mile-an-hour zone.
The Muppet.
Yes, and there's no way he can deny it. You can clearly see it's him behind the wheel of an Audi. There's a photo, and he's got his hands at 10 and 2, so at least he's being safe. Does he even have hands, though? Aren't there, or are they just, like, three fingers?
They are actually human hands stuffed in between those three fingers.
Really?
Yeah, that's part of the magic of the Cookie Monster.
It's not clear who the person in the Cookie Monster costume is, but it happened on September 20th. Police think they staged it and got caught on purpose because they knew the photo would be funny. Cops aren't laughing, though. They put out a statement that said, driving with a mask on is dangerous, and it wouldn't be so funny if you crashed and killed somebody. It's good to remember with Halloween coming up.
Yes.
You can't see the license plate because of glare or police blurred it, but the person could face multiple fines for speeding and driving with a mask on. The two fines combined would be around $100, which is totally worth getting your mugshot put up on a national or worldwide audience.
I'm just looking at
you
the picture.
It? Yeah.
It's ridiculous.
Nom, 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 nom. That's the way that's what his motor sounds like when he drives through.
Sir, do you have any idea how fast you were going?
No. Me go speed limit.
Me go speed limit.
My favorite Cookie Monster parody was Family Guy, where Cookie Monster was in a stall of a bathroom, freebasing cookie dough with a lighter on a spoon.
Yeah.
And actually, once I had a, when my kids were little, my wife would say, hey, you know what? These kids get cold sometimes. You know, have them wear one of our shirts. You know, like, you know. Because it makes the kids feel more comfortable having moms or dad's t-shirts on. Mm-hmm. And they're, like, big, and the kids can, like, swim in them, you know, especially mine.
Right.
And so one night my wife wasn't home, and my kid was cold, and I gave her one of these shirts that I had, and it was a Cookie Monster laid out on the floor with blood pouring out of his arm that said Cookie Cutter. But they were so young, they didn't even know what that was about.
The adorable innocence of babes.
Yeah. So I'm just trying to pad here.
You're not padding here at all, Steve. This is an important story. And I think anybody that took the time to Google the picture of this story of Cookie Monster behind the wheel of, by the way, a very nice luxury vehicle, an Audi. It's a very nice car.
Yeah.
Which makes you think at least he's thinking of in terms of reliability and gas mileage.
Well, Sesame Street must be paying pretty well these days.
Apparently they are.
For an Audi?
Well, you know, I mean, I think times were a little tougher before it all got gentrified.
That's true.
You know?
Yeah. Who do you think the douche is driving the Saab?
Oh, boy. That's so hard to tell. I don't know.
What is it about those cars that these guys, like Cohen's got one. What is it that they think that I don't find them appealing at all.
The Saab?
Yeah.
I don't think they even make Saabs anymore.
Right, but what's the appeal to having one of these cars? I don't see, me, they're not even really that attractive looking.
I think it's the, it's like any luxury vehicle.
Yeah.
You know, it's kind of like when we had Quincy on the other day.
Yeah.
Like, why would someone go and buy a $102,000Tesla truck?
To show you that they have $102,000?
That's
it. Is that what it is?
That's it. It's all status.
Yeah.
I'm thinking you don't buy a Saab unless you feel as though it gives you some level of status.
Yeah.
Meanwhile, the guy at a Plymouth Duster is, you know, driving around town with his muffler dangling on the ground, you know, blasting sparks out the back of his car. He thinks he's kind of a badass. And to be honest with you, given the two, I'd rather be in the Duster.
Yeah, I always thought I was a badass in my little Chevy Celebrity.
Yeah.
My 1984 Chevy Celebrity with all the paint chipped off of it.
I don't mean to make you jealous.
Yeah.
A 1990 totally cherry Chevy Cavalier. Oh,
really?
Man,
that's
no air conditioning, roll down windows, power nothing. Armstrong steering. It had all the stuff that I wish it had.
How many condoms could you fit in the ashtray?
Four.
Yeah. How many times?
Wait. Used or unused?
Unused.
Four.
All right. Well, how many used ones could you fit in?
That's my business.
Yeah.
It's a little personal.
Wadded up like gum.
Yeah, it was totally choice. And that replaced my smoking hot 1983 Toyota Corona.
No, Corona?
A Corona.
I didn't even know they made those.
Yes. It went from 0 to 60 in 4 months.
Well, look at that.
Yeah. Huh? Totally choice.
You were riding high on that.
You're damn right it was.
I had my celebrity had an alternator issue, which I could not afford to fix. So I would have to get out of the car. Every time I got out of the car, I'd have to disconnect the connectors of the battery in order to get it, because it would charge while it was running, but it wouldn't charge without.
Yeah. Of course, the dashboard wouldn't light up, but you don't need that.
No, it lit up.
Really?
It was basic electricity there. But if you left the things plugged in, it would drain the battery. So I would have to either carry jumper cables with me all the time.
Yeah.
Or disconnect the terminals of the battery until I came out from wherever I was.
I remember having an alternator problem with my Cavalier and going into work one day, and the car... You want to talk about great driving. The car died at the very moment I pulled into a parking spot.
Oh, well, that was perfect
timing.
It
was perfect.
Yeah.
And I had a guy that I worked with who knew how to fix that stuff.
Oh, so you had it fixed right then and there.
For $100.
Hey, you can't beat that.
And to this day, I don't think I've ever really paid that guy back in full.
Yeah, but $100 today is like $1 million then.
Oh, yeah. I mean, you're talking
so long ago.
Yeah, you're talking like 1991, maybe. It was, but it was magical the way it just right in there, man.
Yeah.
Totally this, cool.
This car that I had was a gift from my dad.
Yeah.
He gifted me this car, and this car was, he had driven between a crane and a fence with it, so the side panels were all, like, dented in.
Yeah.
There was no paint, there was hardly any paint left on it. It was a gray car, or actually it was green, but it was gray then afterwards because all the paint chipped off of it.
Right.
The alternator didn't work,
mm-hmm.
And then the rear... I don't know if you'd call it that axle thing, you know, with the two tires on either side of it.
Yeah.
It was bent because my brother had gotten sideswiped in an accident that made the car ride like with the tires like kind of at an angle, which taught me how to change a tire very quickly.
Because you're probably going through tires once every 3 weeks.
Yeah, and back in the day, back in the 90s, man, you could get a new tire a used tire from Sears, the auto center.
Yeah, I remember that.
For $5 with another $5 to mount and balance it. It cost me $10, which was like worth the cost of driving mm-hmm. the car.
Now they don't even let you buy just one tire anymore. Now you got to change them all.
And then my friend's mother worked for a baby doll factory.
Yeah.
And she would bring home doll parts because she would like put dolls together.
Yes.
And we had the baby head, just the head, bald baby doll head that my friends and I bonded to the roof of the car. And then cut a hole in the back and shoved a light through it so it glowed down the street while you were driving it.
That is bananas.
Yeah. That's, you know what, that also it made a statement. You know what the statement was?
What?
Pull me over, I need a ticket. Because it also had no catalytic converter as well.
Right.
It had just pipes coming from the header all the way out to the muffler.
But I bet chicks liked it.
Oh, chicks dig that.
Yeah,
thing.
They love. I'll tell you what, chicks love a car with Bondo.
Listen, when I was carrying around that boombox with 8 D cell batteries that we'd have to replace every 3 days, playing the that was my cassette player. And the radio, because the radio didn't work in the car either.
Yeah, yeah. I remember having a date once, and the young lady got in my car, and as we're driving away, she says, "What's dragging?" I said, "That's the drive shaft, honey."
Yeah, that's
Oh, yeah. That was a great night.
I know my brother-in-law, when he started dating my sister, he obviously before he was my brother-in-law, but he had this little red, I think it was a... What's the tiny Chevy? Was it a Chevette or Chevelle? The Chevette was the tiny one.
Yeah, I think you're right.
It was the tiny one, and it was a red, fire engine red, and it was a P piece of crap, and it had a hole in the floor. You could see the road. It was like a, they called it the Fred Flintstone car.
Yeah.
And you had to, he had to park it at the top of the driveway so he could pop start it because the thing didn't start. And he would be driving down the highway at a top speed of 41 miles per hour and smoking cigarettes and dropping them right out the hole in the bottom of the floor.
I had a buddy that had an old VW Bug.
Yeah.
Same thing. Floor was gone. And so was the front seat.
Yeah.
So what he did is, and he is a very highly, he's actually now an MIT professor. This is how brilliant this guy is.
Uh-huh.
He found a way to make a bucket seat using a milk crate and 2x4s.
Oh.
And somehow, somehow it passed inspection.
Yeah, but see, today it wouldn't pass inspection.
Wouldn't. They wouldn't even let that on the road.
Because, again, back in the day, there was always some guy who would, you know, you give him an extra $10, he would pass it for you.
That's the kind of car that puts the pound in impoundment.
Yeah.
You know what I'm talking about?
And then I had to get rid of my car because the guy put it up on the lift, and the lift went right through the frame. And he goes, I'm sorry, I can't inspect this.
Why? What's the matter, dude? It's 7:26 at Rock 102.
GG Inc.
With Bax and Nagle on Rock 102, it's time for news brought to you by Wohlers Builders. For sleek office makeovers to upgrading classrooms or adding ADA accessibility, here's local radio icon Steve Nagle.
Thanks, Bax. Hurricane Milton barreled into the Atlantic Ocean on Thursday after plowing across Florida as a Category 3, pounding cities with ferocious winds and rain, whipping up a barrage of tornadoes and causing an unknown number of deaths. It compounded the misery wrought by Helene while sparing Tampa a direct hit. The storm tracked to the south in the final hours and made landfall Wednesday night in Siesta Key, which is about 70 miles south of Tampa. The situation in the Tampa area was still a major emergency as St. Petersburg recorded over 16 inches of rain, prompting the National Weather Service to warn of a flash flooding there as well as other parts of western and central Florida. The storm knocked out power across a large section of the state, with more than 3.2 million homes and businesses without electricity. The fabric that serves as the roof of Tropicana Field, home of the Tampa Bay Rays baseball team in St. Petersburg, was ripped to shreds by the fierce winds. It was not immediately clear if there was damage inside, although I did hear another report that nobody was injured, which was good.
Thank goodness.
They were housing about 10,000 utility workers in there for a shelter, to be prepared for to go out and take care of the storm afterwards. Multiple cranes were also toppled in the storm, according to the Weather Service. St. Petersburg residents also could no longer get water from their household taps because a water main break led the city to shut down service. But don't they say don't drink the water after a hurricane anyway, because those tanks and stuff get contaminated
right,
with floodwaters and whatnot? Before Milton even made landfall, tornadoes touched down across the state. The Spanish Lakes Country Club near Fort Pierce on Florida's Atlantic coast was particularly hit hard, with homes destroyed and some residents unfortunately killed. About 125 homes were destroyed before the hurricane came ashore, many of them mobile homes and communities for senior citizens. It's going to be a hell of a devastation down there once everything clears and they're able to start getting to people in areas.
16 inches of rain alone, never mind the wind and surges and all that other stuff, that's an enormous amount of rain.
Yeah, 16 inches of rain, and like you said, surging comes after.
Yeah,
like all of that, you know, they're talking, you know, 8 to 10 feet of storm surge afterwards.
I saw this this crazy video last night, and this is, granted, this is from Helene, not necessarily Milton. It's this woman in her house. She lives in an elevated piece of property. There's a road in front of her house, and then on the other side of the road is a river. She's probably in this room taking this video, probably 25 feet up.
Yeah,
from the ground. And she thought, yeah, I should be fine over here. No problem. It's, the river has never surged more than 10 feet. It should be okay. It's probably that now. The following day, she puts another video, and the water is completely wiping out her house.
That's the one I saw, right?
Right. And it's like, well, listen, I know you think you're safe, but what you don't understand is all that water washes away roads and erodes hills and other and parts of the earth. I mean, it's you're not safe.
This was in the mountains, though, right?
Yeah, I think it was.
So, and in their defense, I mean, you know, the lady says in the beginning of the video, "Well, you know, we're pretty safe here because you know it's right at the peak." That river. Was it the same video?
It might have been, yeah.
Where the road and the river were right next to each other?
Yes.
And then the water was all the way up to their window?
Yeah, but there are landslides. There's you know, mudslides. I mean, there's all kinds of erosion that happens. But 16 inches.
But nobody expected that. And nobody, you know, they said you had 100 years of erosion in 24 hours.
Yeah, I know. That's incredible.
That's insane. Here's something kind of funny, though, if you want to see a humorous thing about this whole hurricane stuff. A sheriff's office found drugs during a Helene cleanup and wants to return the items to their owners. The Washington County Sheriff's Office in Georgia said deputies found the drugs while clearing Highway 231 near State Prison in Davisboro. Authorities said they found marijuana, prescription medication, and THC-infused candy. If you'd like to claim ownership of these packages, please come see us.
We'll be waiting for you.
Well, I mean, if you have no home anymore,
yeah,
and those were your items, wouldn't be put in jail be a better alternative than walking the streets full of muck and mud trying to find a place to live?
Theoretically. But on the other hand, if you're going to show up and only be arrested, well, then maybe that's not the best option for you.
It's funny how we think differently in this state because it's legalized.
Yeah, but there are plenty of places in which it's not, and then all of a sudden you're thinking, that's a crime somewhere?
So from what I understand, and I could be wrong about this, but here, if like a kid gets caught with a vape pen full of THC.
Yeah.
You get charged with possession, right?
Okay.
If you're in a state like Georgia or one of those states that that has strict laws still about marijuana, and vapes are concentrate.
Yeah.
So, you know, you could have like a pound of weed in one little thing, the equivalent to a pound of weed. But you're not smoking a pound of weed at once. It's a you know.
Sure.
Thing. But they go by how much weed that would be in other states. So that's where the felony charges start coming in, because now you have like trafficking amounts. A lot of these states have, you know, at least made it a misdemeanor for a simple possession of marijuana. If you had like a less than an ounce of marijuana, you know, you get a fine, like a civil ticket.
I realize it's, you know, in certain states it's still illegal, but that seems to be kind of a stretch to charge somebody for a felony for, you know, a highly concentrated vape pen.
But that's the way the laws are written there, you know.
Wow.
A Kansas woman has been arrested in Florida where she's accused of shooting her husband. According to the Escambia County Sheriff's Office, 31-year-old Jacqueline King was taken into police custody Tuesday night at a hotel in Pensacola Beach in connection with the shooting. Escambia County deputies say they responded to a call that night at a Fairfield Inn hotel. They arrived and found King's husband suffering from a single gunshot wound. He was taken to the hospital for treatment. The sheriff is calling the shooting a domestic-related incident. The couple was on vacation when the shooting happened. King was booked into the Escambia County Jail for attempted homicide. They found her at the pool.
At the pool?
Relaxing at the pool.
Okay.
Shoots the husband. Then goes outside.
Well, she's had a hell of a day.
Somebody heard the gunshot, called 911, but she's out relaxing at the pool.
Strange that you would go through that process of killing someone and then saying, whew, I really could use a dip.
Well, she left a dip to go take a dip. That's, you know, in her eyes.
Sure.
You know, she felt that that was justified for some reason.
Hmm. I'm sure the law doesn't see it that way.
And you know, it might have been justified. He might have been being a dink, like the whole night.
Maybe,
but the action of not just, oh my God, I shot him. I'm gonna call the police. No, I'm gonna take the. You got the extra key card with you?
Where is it? It's in my back pocket. Let me grab that from you. I'm going down to take a dip. I'll be back in a couple hours.
Again, she's had a hell of a day. Is there a better way to unwind than, you know, cannonballing into the pool?
No, I don't think so. I mean, you might as well enjoy yourself before, because you're not going to be enjoying yourself in jail.
That's the truth.
So you might as well just do it. A ribbon cutting was held for the rehabilitation of an access road leading to the Quabbin Reservoir. Funding of $652,000 was awarded from the American Rescue Plan Act to repave approximately 1.75 miles from outside Gate 43 just before the bridge. The roadway provides visitors easier access for the use of fishing, walking, running, and bike riding. Which one of those do you do in general?
None.
The ribbon cutting ceremony was held with the DCR commissioners, Brian Arrigo, along with Director of Rural Affairs, Ann Gobi, State Senators Peter Durant and Jake Olivieri, and State Representatives Todd Smola and Aaron Saunders. The biggest event to happen at the Quabbin, and nobody was there.
Sad, although, you know, a lot of people go to the Quabbin. It is beautiful.
We've talked about this before. That whole documentary of how the Quabbin was formed, or how it was, they destroyed all of those towns. They just destroyed everything.
Yeah.
Like, that was the solution to get a basin of water for Boston, was to eliminate, what is it, four towns or something?
It was like three or four towns. Yeah.
Just insane.
Those towns weren't really doing very much, though, Steve.
You don't think so?
Nah, they're just taking up space.
I wonder what kind of hidden treasures are down below the Quabbin waters.
I think most of it has been cleared out, but there's a lot of stuff. There is a lot of stuff down there.
Yeah.
You can't just evacuate an entire town and not pick up after yourself.
Yeah, there's like a fish living down there in a church all by himself.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, look what I moved into.
Like a bunch of trout hanging by like a greasy spoon diner that used to be down in Enfield, Massachusetts.
I wonder if the fish sleeps on the wall of the church, like when you go into a regular church, you see the fish and the Omega sign.
Yeah. I'm sure that's what happens.
The Jesus fed everybody with the fish, right?
Yes, loaves.
Was it Jesus? Who did that?
It was Jesus.
Yeah, that'd be interesting.
He never showed up to a party empty-handed.
I saw a meme yesterday where it was the Seinfeld episode where they were talking to George Costanza about, you know, when George quit his job but then go back in there on Monday like nothing happened.
Yes.
Well, it was Jerry talking to Jesus. And Jesus goes, what, so just show up on Sunday like nothing ever happened? Well, why not? I think that would be a good plan. That would be a good plot for a show. Your Pioneer Valley forecast today, going to be a mix of sun and clouds with a high of 59. Tomorrow, sunny with a high of 66. It's 44 right now in downtown Springfield. I'm Steve Nagle, and that's the news on Rock 102. Oh, yeah.
Decorating with pumpkins is fun, but decorating with
Rock 102, Springfield's classic rock. It's just about 7:52 with Queen at Rock 102.
Mix of sun and clouds today with a high of 59. Tomorrow, sunny with a high of 66. It's 44 right now in downtown Springfield.
Now, keep your fingers crossed. Scott Zolak, maybe next hour to talk about Patriot football.
Maybe. We'll find out.
Yes, I know. So him after 8 o'clock, as well as the keyword to cash, your chance to win $1,000. We give you the keyword. You'll have until midnight tonight to put that in, and if you do it by midnight, you could win $1,000.
How about that?
That's a really cool thing.
Sunday's my birthday.
I know. What are you going to be, 45, 46?
46.
Wow.
Can you imagine that?
Man, it's like I remember you when you were 26.
You do remember me when I was 26.
Yeah.
Which is crazy. Guess what I'm going to be doing?
I don't know.
I'll be volunteering. I'll be spinning tunes for the Whip City Animal Sanctuary.
On your birthday?
Yeah, why not?
Do you want to be out celebrating with like a cookie puss ice cream cake or party hats and favors and stuff?
No, I'm not doing that.
You're not going to get like a bounce house in your backyard?
I don't really do anything for my birthday. I'm not like 12, you know? Like
you're gonna celebrate like a whole birthday week by like going out to like, you know, bachelorette parties and that kind of thing, getting a limo and
I'm gonna
stuff
buy,
like that.
I'm gonna buy myself a cake. How about that?
Wow!
I'll buy myself a cake.
for my birthday. Yeah, and I'll eat it all by myself.
You know, I'm at the point now where I'm kind of like the same way with birthdays. It just doesn't seem to be anything more than just another day.
My favorite pastime of my birthday in my elder years now is going to like a Big Y or Stop and Shop and see which one of them has the bazingas to write happy birthday penis on the birthday cake. Because some of them won't do it.
They won't?
I'm not doing that. But some of them will be like, yeah, I'll do it.
They should be. I mean, they should be able to do it. I mean, if you're paying for them to do it,
I don't think.
What's the problem?
Because I think some people are offended by that. They don't want to do that. They don't want to be the one that wrote "Happy Birthday, Penis."
Suppose it's actually your name.
You have to prove it. You have to pull out your ID.
You are. Hello, this is Mr. Penis Nagle here. I would like a cake.
No, my name is just Penis. There's
just
no
penis.
First or last name. It's just, it's like the Hulk, you know. Like,
well, most bakers don't
the
ask.
The penis.
Yeah, but most bakers don't ask for a first and last name when they're writing on a cake. They just want a name. Usually it's a first name.
Yeah.
In your case, it would be Penis.
Happy birthday, Penis.
I don't see why anybody would have a problem with
that. I wonder what the most vulgar thing you could ask somebody at a grocery store or bakery to write on your cake. Like, could you go with the AH, or can you go with the F word? Can you do any of that stuff?
I don't see why you couldn't.
Yeah.
It's just a word. It's not going to ruin the flavor of the cake.
How about sea monster, but instead of cookie, it means something else?
Yeah, right. Yeah. Again, if you're paying for it.
Well, I guess this will be experimental weekend.
Once you cut into it, it's like no one's going to remember what was on top of it. They're just going to remember whether the cake is delicious or not.
Yes, but is that the first thing you lick off? Is that word?
It wouldn't be my first choice.
Or you save it for the last.
Yeah, maybe.
Save it for the end.
Long as you take a picture of the cake before it's cut or lit on fire, I think that's the way memories are made.
I think there's something seriously wrong with me.
Really? You think so?
Yeah, there might be.
That's interesting. Hey, Saturday happens to be the home opener for the Springfield Thunderbirds. They're taking on Laval, the Laval Rockette.
Yeah.
And... you know, it is a Thunderbird Thursday, the first one of the year, and we happen to have a four-pack of tickets to Saturday's home opener. You'll also win four hats, four koozies, and one drawstring bag, so you can put all that awesome stuff inside of it.
You're talking about the hockey team. I thought you were talking about the malt liquor.
No.
Because, you know, that's the way to celebrate my birthday.
With a
Thunderbird Thursday. Yeah. Anybody got a pack of GPCs as well?
No, we don't have those. All but right. The 10th caller right now at 293-1021 to win the Springfield Thunderbirds prize package. Four tickets to Saturday's home opener. How great does that sound?
That sounds fantastic.
It's Bax and Nagle on Rock 102. Rock 102, Springfield's classic rock. It's 8:10. And John Mellencamp with Bax and Nagle and Rock 102.
Going to be a mix of sun and clouds today with a high of 59. Tomorrow, sunny with a high of 66. It's 44 right now in downtown Springfield.
All right, real quickly, it's time to give you the keyword to cash for today. Your chance to win $1,000 on Rock 102. Today, the keyword is the word farm. That's farm, as in F-A-R-M, for those of you who have never spelt that word out in your life.
Something that Old MacDonald once had.
He had a farm, and that is how we use it in a sentence. Again, you have until midnight tonight to enter into that keyword on rock102.com. Could be worth $1,000. Again, the word is farm, F-A-R-M.
Well,
okay?
Sounds like a farm team is playing up in Foxborough.
Jesus, if only. Scott, Scott Zolak, brought to you by Window World of Western Mass. Good morning, Scott. How you doing?
Morning, guys. That rings a bell. Farm. Where did you lose your virginity? At the farm.
Wow.
At a Cumberland farm behind the dumpster.
Yeah, exactly. In the bathroom.
Hey, dude, I heard audio of you enjoying the game last Sunday against Miami, and it didn't seem like you were really enjoying yourself that much.
Well, I convey the atmosphere. That's what I do. I paint the picture if your eyes are closed, and if it's good, it's good. If it's bad, it's bad.
I mean,
it was pretty bad on Sunday.
It was brutal, and the thing about it is, you know, this was a team. You know, the Dolphins are a team that was not playing well. They're not a very good team. The Patriots had the chance to put this thing away, and they just continue to make more and more mistakes and shoot themselves in the foot with that toe heel garbage.
Yeah, that's the rule, though. Yeah, that burned us a couple of years ago down in Atlanta. Brandon Bolden caught one going to the sideline that way. Tom Brady threw the ball high to him, and it was a hell of a catch. We all thought it was a catch, but the new rule started that year, and well, it's BS. They should change the rule. I don't like the rule.
I don't like the rule either, because I think, you know, 90% of the time, that would just be allowed, because what an incredible effort this kid had, and it just all went away. It was such a shame.
What's funny, like, you could dive over the pile at the goal line and land on your forearm and elbow, and that instantaneously is a touchdown because it's the part of the arm that hits. Not your whole arm, but just the forearm. So why can't the toes just touch? Why does it have to be the whole foot?
I know.
It makes no sense.
You know, so as you're watching the game and you're seeing this thing unfold the way it's unfolding, I mean, there's so many problems here. There's so many things that appear to be glaring. I need to ask you the question, is the problem having Jacoby Brissett on the field, or is it much worse than that?
No, he's definitely part of the problem. Like, he is not elevated, and he's not played better game to game. You know, good veteran players, good veteran quarterbacks, they're able to play a little bit better each and every game. It seems like Jacoby's got a little worse every game. It's a combination of things. It's blocking up front. It's not getting open with the receivers. It's maybe a bad play call. It's maybe a bad throw by Jacoby. Sunday, we were running the ball over 7 yards a clip. We had that drive and we get down inside the 10, and then we threw it 4 times.
Yeah.
It's like, what are we doing? You know, it's just, we don't know how to win games yet. You know, that's one where, you know, you really had that sucker there.
When you look at you know, how they're doing and how the offense is operating, how much would you put on the coaches in a situation like that? And we lost
him. Wow, he hung up on us.
Such a good question.
Yeah.
Should I call him back?
You could try.
All right, I'll try to call him back. Hold on a second.
Unless he's going to try calling. It's one of those things where he's going to try calling you. You're calling him, and then.
All right, let's see if that works. Hey, there you are.
Hey, there you are.
Sorry about that.
Yeah.
Hey, these things happen. Anyway, so my question is, I mean, how much would you put on the coaching in a situation like this?
I'll put a lot on it. That's what I think I worry about the most now since Drake's going in. Is he going to be coached well? Will he be put in good positions? Will he know how to maybe bail himself out of a certain protection if he needed to be instead of taking a hit? All that's in play. There's a huge element in the unknown because everything's new. Everybody's known.
You know, and people appear to be rather split on this, and you know, obviously from the beginning of the season, you know, Jerod Mayo was split on this, or you know, very much focused on the fact that, you know, the kid needs to develop. But as I'm watching, you know, other reporters report on this, you know, Dan Orlovsky from ESPN saying that this is a mistake to put a Drake May in, but I think at this point they can't do any worse, so maybe putting him in is the best. The best idea. You're a former quarterback. What's your thought about it?
Well, I'm being a former quarterback, and I think I'm a smart guy, and I think I don't listen to Dan Orlovsky because he thinks it's ridiculous to put him in, and then he says at the same time that he loves Alex Van Pelt's scheme and think he does a great job at play calling. So you tell me who's right and who's wrong. Dan Orlovsky doesn't even watch the games here. So it's, you know, you people watch them. You see it. It's getting harder and harder to watch. Now you're 1-4. You got a stretch of games here that are winnable games. Texans are going to be a tough game. We got to go to London next week. It's time to play the kid. You should have played the kid before the damn Miami Dolphin game. That was the perfect spot to play it. That team sucked.
Well, you got a bunch of other guys on the team that I'm sure are watching this, and they're observing what these decisions are, and they have to be getting frustrated if they're seeing Jacoby not elevating his play, and then all of a sudden they've got a guy who appears to be the future of the Patriots, just kind of sitting there biding his time. I mean, veteran players are paying attention to all of this stuff.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, veteran players more so than anything. And there's going to be a time that comes, and maybe it is coming soon, where it's the other 53 guys. It's the safety that's playing with the cracked arm. He's getting 53 snaps. Or another guy pushing through a high ankle sprain. He's asking himself, what the hell am I doing this for? Why am I breaking my balls when we get the best quarterback on the team and they won't even play him?
Yeah.
Like, guys aren't stupid. They'll see that in practice. They'll be like, why is this kid doing really well in practice, but he can't even get on the field? and yet I'm getting my ass kicked each and every day. Screw this.
I want to ask you about so with this game in Houston. Obviously, Houston is 4-1. They're a really good team. Even if Drake May goes in there and doesn't win, it does not mean that this is that the Patriots are doomed. At what point do you say that this is going to be a successful game for Drake May or an unsuccessful game?
Good question. I think, get him through. I think it'll be successful. Get through four quarters. Don't have any delay games. Maybe have a turnover or two, but lead the team to three touchdowns. Say you lose 30-20 and he moved the ball. It just looks better from the other four games. That's a win in itself right there.
We got some.
Well, I have a personal motto when it comes to situations like this, and that is there's always next year.
Yeah.
Well, you're five games in.
Yeah, sure, for what?
Now, if the Patriots were a food, what would it be and why? Soggy fries or overcooked pasta? I'm not sure.
I know liver.
Yeah, a liver.
Yeah, right. No one likes to have that.
Some people do like them, and they acquire a taste for them, so they will watch them, and most don't.
I think we should replace Pat the Patriot with an ostrich because they should bury their heads in the sand when they're done with the game.
I want to hit that thing. I want to hit that thing with a football so hard.
Right.
You know they can't see. They can't see jacking in there. You know, so they just walk around waving the fans.
That would make great headlines, Scott. You could paint them right off the head and see what happens.
Not my fault. He didn't see the ball coming.
Right. That's it. I want to ask you about this Jabril Peppers fiasco. Here's a guy, he's a captain of the team. He gets arrested over the weekend. He's now been placed on the commissioner's exempt list.
Yep.
What does just explain what that list means? I mean, he's not able to play, obviously. He still gets paid, but what are the other restrictions on him in this?
Can't come to the building, can't practice, can't go to film, can't be around the team. You're just pushed away.
So
not allowed to be anywhere near football.
I mean,
that's the biggest part of it.
I mean, the NFL is doing this obviously for a clear reason. It appears as though that these legitimate charges against them, and they're horrific. Everything you hear about this makes you wonder how was this guy seen as a leader of this team or anything else for that matter. How do other players respond to when situations like this happen? I mean, everyone's trying to be, focused on the game, and here's a guy considered to be a leader in the club messing up and not being a part of this. It has to infuriate some players.
I don't know if it does as much as you think, because the guy was here last year. The team loves him. I love him as a player. He's one of my favorite guys because he knocks your head off. He stayed around all offseason, worked out a ton, earned captain. And was your starting safety, and you play together with him, and hey, I screwed up this Thursday. He went off the rails one Friday. The other 99% of the time, he's perfect. So I think it's good they put him on the list, because if he's not on the list, he's probably getting cut. The Crafts have a no tolerance policy for domestic violence, but we got to let this play through to make sure that he is guilty of what he's accused of.
Yeah. Scott, we're losing the connection a little bit, but we will talk to you.
Okay.
We'll talk to you next week as you get ready for the London game, right, against Jacksonville?
Next Thursday I'll be getting on a plane to go to London. That'll be fun.
Awesome.
All right.
We will talk to you then, Scott.
Cheerio.
All right. Cheerio. Scott Zolak, brought to you by Window World. It's 8:21 on Rock 102. Rock 102 Springfield's Classic Rock. It's 8:28. Brian Adams from Bax and Nagle of Rock 102.
Summer.
I know, that's the funniest part of the title.
That whole thing, yeah.
Hey, this week on Baxy's Musical Podcast, my guest is the legendary Tony Levin. Was played bass on over 500 different albums, including King Crimson, all of Peter Gabriel's solo records. He also played on Pink Floyd's Momentary Lapse of Reason, Double Fantasy from John Lennon. He's played with everybody, and he's an amazing, amazing musician. He's going to be at the Schubert in Boston on Friday, along with Adrian Belew, Steve Vai, and Danny Carey, their new band called Beat, playing 80 versions of King Crimson songs. An amazing talent. Next week, Susanna Schaffel. She is an amazing singer. Actually, she was a season 3 contestant on The Voice, but her music career has really taken off. She's got a brand new record out called Bird by Bird. It really is awesome. So she'll be my guest this Monday on Apple Podcasts, SoundCloud, Spotify, and on rock102.com, as well as the Rock 102 app, brought to you by Metro, Chrysler, Dodge, Jeep, and Ram at Chicopee, and Rock 102, Springfield's Classic Rock.
Coming up in the news, raccoons gone crazy. Mental illness awry.
That's coming up next. So,
before we go any further, because I will talk about the raccoons coming up in news, but somebody sent me, I'm trying to see, I don't know what it was. They 22 News put something up. It says what's your favorite haunted attraction in New England? And the guy that sent this to me says, thanks to you, every time I read something that starts at "what's with your favorite," I hear Dave Coombs' voice. Thanks a lot, Steve. What's your favorite Halloween costume story?
Less yesterday, I had someone message me and said, every time you make fun of Dave Coombs, it makes me laugh. Yeah. And like, you know what? And listen, if people love it, we're going to keep on doing it because Lord knows we're enjoying the hell out of it.
And you know what? People might say, well, that's a childish thing to do. The man doesn't even work here anymore. That's more the reason to do it.
Yeah, and I hate to break it to you. We're two childish men.
Yes. What's your favorite childish man story? 293-1021.
News is next at Rock 102.
If you see me...
834 with Bax and Nagle and Rock 102. It's time for news brought to you by Bank ESB. Unlock your potential with Bank ESB's Get Real Checking. Here's local radio icon Steve Nagle.
Thanks, Bax. You know, as we're dealing with back-to-back hurricanes, you know, we could always use some better news, like a severe solar storm that's headed towards Earth that could stress power grids. Space weather forecasters said yesterday.
Oh, great timing.
The NOAA issued a severe geomagnetic storm watch for Thursday into Friday after an outburst from the sun was detected earlier this week. Such a storm could temporarily disrupt power and radio signals. NOAA has notified operators of power plants and orbiting spacecraft to take precautions. It also alerted the FEMA about possible power disruptions as the organization copes with the devastating aftermath of Hurricane Helene and gears up for the Hurricane Milton that's barreled across the Gulf of Mexico over Florida. Forecasters do not expect the latest solar storm to surpass the one that slammed Earth in May, the strongest in more than two decades. But they won't know for sure until it's just 1 million miles away, where spacecraft can actually measure it.
Okay.
Florida is not far enough south to avoid any power disruptions from the solar surge unless it gets a lot bigger, said scientist Rob Steinberg of the NOAA's weather prediction crew. That adds a little bit more to the comfort level. Why we're here is to let them know so that they can prepare. Well, the sun is far away. About 93 million miles away.
Yes.
Yes.
It is.
And the sun is so hot.
How hot is it, Steve?
It's so hot that everything on it is a gas.
Interesting.
Yeah. Whew. But the sun is hot. The sun is not a place where we could live. But here on Earth, there'd be no light without the light it gives.
That's right, Steve.
You should write that down.
You should write it into maybe a song. Yeah.
But the cool thing is, the storm may also trigger the Northern Lights as far south in the U.S. as the lower Midwest and Northern California, though exact locations and times are uncertain. Somebody posted a couple of pictures of the ones that were from the other day. That was pretty neat.
You know, this summer, my wife and I tried to see the Northern Lights because we heard it was going to be they were going to be out, and we were out real late. And we're driving around waiting to see it. Didn't see Bupkis. Didn't see Jack Squat.
That's a song by Glenn Campbell, isn't it? Northern Lights?
That's Southern Lights.
It's Nights. Southern Nights.
That's Southern Nights, Steve. But a very good song from the great late Glenn Campbell.
I think we should pull that up. You don't have that handy?
I mean, if you give me a moment.
Well, I don't know if we have a moment.
Well, we got
maybe
time.
Maybe we should just
What are you talking
scrap.
About?
We got time? What kind of time?
All the time.
What kind of time do we have?
Well, we got I'll tell you what. It's time to play some Glenn Campbell is what we got. Yeah.
The Royal Philharmonic Orchestra.
Southern Nights. Have you ever felt a Southern Night? Free as a breeze.
Oh, yeah.
Free as a breeze. Not to mention the trees. Whistling tunes that you know and love so.
Oh,
Southern Nights. Just as good as even when you close your eyes. I apologize to anyone who can truly say he has found a better way.
The voice of an angel, didn't he?
You wouldn't know by this song, but Glenn Campbell was one of the greatest guitar players of all time.
Was he really?
Honestly.
Glenn Campbell?
Glenn Campbell used to play with the Wrecking Crew.
Oh, really? No, he didn't.
Yes, he did.
He did?
Yeah.
I had no idea.
Look it up. Play with the Wrecking Crew. There were like tens of thousands of recordings.
The Wichita Lineman
played
with the Wrecking Crew?
Along with the great Hal Blaine, Holyoke's very own Hal Blaine.
Gentle on My Mind was always a good song, but I absolutely love Rhinestone Cowboy.
Yeah, that's a beautiful song.
Well, it's his name in lights. He's been walking these streets so long, singing the same old song. He knows every crack in the sidewalks of Broadway. There you go. I knew you were going to do it.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
I've been walking these streets so long, singing the same old song. I know every crack in these dirty sidewalks of Broadway. Where hustle's the name of the game, and nice guys get washed away like the snow and the rain. There's been a load of compromising
load
on the road to my horizon. But I'm gonna be where the lights are shining on me, like a rhinestone cowboy. Riding out on a horse in a star-spangled rodeo. Ba-ba-ba. Like a rhinestone cowboy. Getting cards and letters from people I don't even know. And offers coming over the phone.
Oh, man. Again, voice of an angel, that guy.
Did you know that he was also briefly a member of the Beach Boys?
He was also a member of the local Elks Club. Did you know that?
I did not know that.
Yeah,
but
yeah. That's
makes you think.
His biggest accomplishment was passing the test to become a member of the Elks.
Yes.
I believe he was signing the book and rolling the dice every day.
Yes. The great.
He was playing.
Glenn Campbell.
Glenn Campbell is rolling in his grave with your rendition of Southern Nights.
You know what? I don't like hearing that. And to be quite honest with you, I think we're pouring every bit of emotion we have into these great Glenn Campbell classics.
And I can't believe this guy said that about Glenn Campbell. His body might not be walking around, but his soul lives on forever right here on Rock 102.
Lineman for the county, and I drive the main road,
searching for the sun for the road.
Anyway, I don't know
that one that well.
It's a beautiful song.
That's more of a background song. That's not meant to be spoken.
All right, well, I'll play it in the background lightly.
Oh, you know what? We should play yacht rock type of stuff while we're doing the news. Then
wait
it
a
won't
minute.
Make sound.
Are you confusing Glenn Campbell with yacht rock?
Yeah.
I am not going to sit here and listen to that.
Well, it's yacht rock.
It's not. It's a beautiful country classic.
Well, it's country, but it's a crossover tune.
Come on, the dude was a rhinestone cowboy.
Right, but he was also a Southern Night guy.
Well, don't make me play Galveston, because I'll tell you what, I'm not going to get through that very easily either.
Look how much better the news stories sound with that playing in the background right here. Ready? Nearly 10 million pounds of ready-to-eat meat and poultry products have been recalled due to a possible listeria contamination, the USDA Food and Safety Inspection Service announced on Wednesday. The approximately 9 million pounds of meat were produced by Bruce Pack, a food company located in Durant, Oklahoma. According to the recall, the ready-to-eat products were produced from June 19th of 2024 to October 8th and shipped to distributors nationwide.
You know, when I hear a story like that, and I hear Glenn Campbell in the background, I'm almost happy to have explosive diarrhea.
I know. It makes it a little bit easier on your bowels, doesn't it?
Sure does.
Listen, you could have... but the thing that soothes that out is the angelic voice of the late, great Glenn Campbell. Yeah.
Man.
Yeah. The products were subject to recall. Bear establishments numbers 51205 or P150205 inside or under the USDA mark of inspection. So if you're looking to get listeria and relax and enjoy some Glenn Campbell, now's the time to do it.
If you're suffering from a spastic colon, please make sure you have an extra dose of Glenn Campbell.
Ah. A woman was murdered brutally this morning. I couldn't go into something like that. Like, that's the one you don't want to go into.
Yeah, that's a very angular transition.
Is the thing. Your Pioneer Valley forecast, though, it is going to be... I'm glad we got to the news.
All right, we may not have gotten to the news, but we did get to Glenn Campbell, and aren't we all happy for that?
Where else... can you not hear news but celebrate a legend? Right here on the Bax and Nagle Show. That's why we were nominated for a Marconi Award.
But maybe this is why we didn't win.
Yeah, because that one guy doesn't like the Wichita Lineman song. You know what? We were going to give it to him, and then we heard them play Glenn Campbell.
Yeah, if they had played Ambrosia, they could have won this award.
How much do you feel? Your Pioneer Valley forecast today is going to be a mix of sun and clouds with a high of 59. Tomorrow, sunny with a high of 66. It's 46 right now in downtown Springfield. I'm Steve Nagle, and that's the news on Rock 102. Oh, yeah.
You know the...
Rock 102, Springfield's classic rock. It's 8:52, and Alice in Chains with Bax and Nagle on Rock 102.
Mix of sun and clouds today with a high of 59. Tomorrow, sunny with a high of 66. It's 46 right now in downtown Springfield.
Speaking of tomorrow we'll have an open line Friday. Now, I just want to establish some ground rules for tomorrow, because I don't know if the last 2 weeks people were really embracing the rules as they're written. When you call tomorrow and you have something to say in open line Friday, no foul language, no hate speech, try not to act like a dink. Those are the three catch-all rules of open line Friday.
I don't think people listen to that, though.
They should.
Well, because the last couple of times we've done this, there's been a lot of dinks.
It's been like nothing but dinks.
Another dink in the armor is what we'd like to say around here.
Is it possible to get through a whole week being completely dink-free? I haven't seen it yet.
I have no idea. Hey, before we get into our next giveaway here, because we've got one going, you're a music guy.
Sure.
We were just singing music. Right. That's what we were doing in the news. What would the song you'd want to hear in your final moments of your life? Because I like to go dark.
Well, I mean, if I'm picking my favorite song of all time, like if that's the one that I'd go out with.
Yeah.
My favorite song of all time is God Only Knows by the Beach Boys.
That's a pretty great tune.
That's a great song. Pure genius.
The whole album would be something.
Pet Sounds would be a great way to go out.
I don't know what I would pick. It's a little morbid to think about, because it would be the last song you will ever hear.
Yeah.
Hopefully it's not a Tom Petty song, but
but if it had to be a Tom Petty song.
But they did it. There was a survey, John.
Oh, jeez, I wasn't ready for this. Hold on a second.
They said.
Over what big snot rocket just came out of my nose. Over one thing. Yeah, can I have that, tissue there?
A little tissue.
Just wipe the gully here. What's going on? Anyway, over 1,000 people shared their loved one's bucket kicking song request. It's worth mentioning that the survey was done in the UK, What do they know about dying?
Well, they die. They die at the same clip that most of us do.
I thought they were just invincible.
No, hardly.
Aside from one song by Robbie Williams, they're pretty universally known, though. Number one, a little too cliche. "My Way" by Frank Sinatra.
Oh,
come
please.
On. That's what you want to hear in the final moments of your life.
You're going to go out. Don't be a hack.
"I Will Always Love You" by Whitney Houston.
That's all right.
"The Best" by Tina Turner.
Well, that's pretty self-congratulatory, don't you think?
"Over the Rainbow" by Judy Garland.
Yeah, that's a beautiful song.
Yeah, it is self-congratulatory. That you,
that are simply
Turner.
The best?
Yeah. "Girls Just Want to Have Fun" by Cyndi Lauper.
Okay, what's a different to spin in the mood?
"Angels" by Robbie Williams. I don't know if I know that song.
Yeah, I don't know that.
"What a Wonderful World" by Louis Armstrong.
Mm-hmm.
"Beautiful" by Christina Aguilera. "Hey Jude" from the Beatles.
Well, that's a 7-minute long song.
So I guess you're trying to get as much as you can out of it.
Yeah.
Well, wouldn't you pick like Inagata DeVito or Alice's Restaurant?
I'd pick like "Close to the Edge" by Yes. It gives me good almost 19 minutes of extra time.
And "These Are the Days of Our Lives" by Queen.
Yeah, that's, I mean, that's again, you know, these are sad, maudlin songs. You know, I just rather go out feeling good about it.
What about "Closer" by Nine Inch Nails? That's the one I'd like.
There you
to
go.
Hear.
Yeah. Now we're talking.
Yeah. That's what I'm talking about.
I'd play that now, but I don't believe I have the edited version, the safe for radio.
Or "Creep"
by Radiohead.
Yeah, Radiohead.
Yeah, Radiohead. That'd be a good way to go out too.
Or you could hear "You're So Bad" by Tom Petty. Or you could hear "Free Fallin'." Or, wait, you're listening to Rock 102, your last moments of your life?
Man, you're in hell before you die?
That is crazy! Crazy!
Speaking of Tom Petty, there's a brand new documentary out. Actually, it's not new. What?
Smooth transition.
I know. Yeah, well, you brought it up.
Well, that's why I did it.
You give me the John Stockton assist right there. You're like Bob Cousy on the hardwood.
Oh, no. I feel more I'm like a David Copperfield or a David Blaine.
Anyway, there's a Tom Petty documentary called Heartbreakers Beach Party. It came out years ago, but now it is being reissued, and it's only being reissued on two nights, October 17th and 20th. It's the first time in years this thing has been shown. It's an absolute classic, and it's being shown locally at either the Hampshire Mall or at Buckland Hills. And we have a pair of tickets to see this documentary for the first time in years. And again, only on those 2 days.
Yeah.
10th caller right now, 293-1021, will get to go see the film.
So wherever you live, you got to drive all the way here, pick up the tickets, and then drive all the way to either the Hampshire Mall or the Buckland Hills Mall. It's totally worth time.
Actually, I think the tickets get emailed to you. I don't think you have to drive all the way here.
I was trying to make a point.
Yeah, I know what you're trying to do, but that's not actually how it's working. But it's supposed to be a great film. I have not seen it. My.com. And it was directed by Cameron Crowe, his very first film.
Oh, Cameron Crowe.
That's right.
I liked her in Something About Mary.
Yes, she was... Yeah, she's a very attractive woman.
Yeah.
That Cameron Crowe. Yeah. Good luck on Rock 102.